Hello, today I'm going to be talking about if increasing the intensity of TDCS boosts its outcome. I'm not going to say too much as far as background about TDCS, assuming you know it. Very briefly, TDCS uses a low power source to apply current to electrodes that are placed on the head. The typical amount of current that's applied is between 1 and 2 milliamps, and that fact is rather important to what I'm going to talk about today. And TDCS is tested for a very wide range of indications, both in healthy individuals to enhance performance and for different clinical reasons. And again, that's also not something I'm going to unpack today, except that I want to say that there have been thousands of clinical trials using TDCS, currently hundreds of ongoing registered trials with a very wide range of indications, spanning, as I mentioned, both medical indications, everything from depression, different forms of depression, different forms of chronic pain, and to applications in healthy individuals aimed to enhance performance, such as enhancing even things like creativity. And again, my goal here isn't to unpack how TDCS works, and there's certainly been a lot of work on the cellular mechanisms of TDCS, but I do want to say a little bit about why TDCS can be used for so many different indications. And the basic concept is that TDCS is never applied alone. Typically, you start with some sort of training regime, some sort of therapy, let's say it's cognitive behavioral therapy, that or rehabilitation, and that in its own produces some sort of benefit. Now, you combine TDCS with that form of training and with that form of therapy, and the idea is that whatever benefit you might otherwise get over a fixed period of treatments or time, TDCS will now give you more bang for the buck. A bigger benefit for the same match treatment. And that's where the specificity comes from. The specificity doesn't come from simply the TDCS on its own. The specificity comes from the task, the training that TDCS is partnered with. What I do want to focus on for today is the fact that across all these studies that are now spanning over 15 years of TDCS, and across all these different indications, essentially all of them use a current between 1 and 2 milliamps. And that's it, and some use 1.5. So regardless of indication, regardless of subject population, as a rule, they're using these two intensities. And certainly from the perspective of dose response, you know, you'd want to ask the question, are we using the right amount? Is all the effort we're putting into ongoing trials, we're using the best possible current to get these outcomes? And there's two specific sub-questions that relate to that. One is, basically, is 2 better than 1? TDCS started as 1 around 2003. 2 milliamp was used for different clinical indications with the notion of trying to produce a bigger outcome than you would with 1. That was simply a guess. And that's 2003. And things have sort of stopped. Clinical trials have continued to use 2 milliamp as sort of the go-to. So is 2 really bigger than 1? And what about going above 2? Certainly, the electrode technology that we have today allows tolerable stimulation at above 2 milliamps. There's certainly been techniques suggested to increase that delivery several fold, but is that what we want to do, right? Is 3 better than 2 and so on? And these seem very critical questions for the field. Now, a lot of the things I'm going to be talking about today, this thought discussion actually started at Amherst with a special conference that was convened by the Air Force to look at the mechanisms of TDCS, but specifically ask questions about dose. And most of the data I'll be showing you today is from this particular publication, which was really a thought piece, a review. And as you could tell from the title, as far as is more, we certainly found the evidence base incomplete. This is the approach that we took. We basically looked at the data, looking at the effects of TDCS on different scales, modeling, dosimetry, cellular level, preclinical animal trials, then human clinical neurophysiology, all the way leading to behavior and treatment. And essentially what we said is, well, if TDCS has a nonlinear, non-monotonic effect at any given scale, so for example, if at the cellular scale, you double intensity, but then the effect goes away, our thinking was that if it happened in any one scale, then it might also happen across the totality. And that's sort of illustrated in this figure here. I certainly don't expect you to take all of this in right now. I will unpack each one of these pieces in detail, but going from on the left from the top to bottom, first you have the dose applied, whether it's the so-called nodal TDCS with the anode over the target, at 1 milliamp or 2 milliamp, you can reverse the polarity. You can also consider other montages like high definition montage. And each one of those will produce a current flow pattern in the brain. That's what's shown in the next row. That will then affect cells through membrane polarization, and then lead to changes in synaptic efficacy, synaptic plasticity, network function, all the way up to network level, and ultimately cognition and behavior. And the question is, if you start all the way at the top with, let's say, the 1 milliamp anode, and you produce a 1x change. If we go to 2 milliamp anode, will we produce a 2x change through some linear cascade all the way down? Or if we reverse the polarity and go from 2 to minus 2, will we somehow reverse that cascade of effects? And what happens when we do different montages, like high definition montages that are more focal? So just moving ahead quickly, I want to start with a discussion about at this first stage, which really has to do with current flow models and dosimetry. And it turns out that at this stage, to a first approximation, things are linear, which means that as we add more current, the current density in the brain, or we talk about electric field in the brain, will increase. This is something that we've known for a pretty long time, starting with our work and other people's work, looking at high resolution models. And this is what those models look like. So this is a computer simulation. It's actually of my head. And there's an electrode, at least one on the left side of my head. It's an anode and it's pushing current in. And there you see in the prediction, a false color map of where the current goes, where hotter colors have more current in, more current intensity. And we know several things from these simulations, which have been validated. One thing we know is that the pattern that you see in the head will depend on where you put the electrodes. So as we move the electrodes around, where these hot spots emerge will move around. And the other thing you can tell is it's not one hot spot. It's not just one glowing region of red and blue everywhere else. It's clustered. It's distributed, and this is also a direct consequence of how the current flows through the head. We know that for any given region of the brain, if we start with 1 milliamp and we go to 2 milliamp, the electric field in that region of the brain will double, and similarly it'll double in each other region. But where we'll end up is different because where it starts will be different. And this does lead to a problem. Even at this scale, we're talking about simple dose response, and that relates to this notion of individual variation. And so there's a lot going on in this slide, but let me talk you through it slowly. I want you to first focus on the top row. So the top row is a simulation of three subjects. The one on the left is me. And they're all getting the M1 SO montage. It's the sort of montage that's used for stimulation of the motor cortex. It's tested for in pain disorders, in rehab, and so on. But the point here is you can see in the computer simulation just by eye, you can see that across these three individuals, all getting the exact same montage and the exact same current, the resulting prediction of what happens in the brain is different because all these individuals have different head sizes. So you can see, for example, on me, the peak was 0.47, on the next subject it was 0.48, on the next subject the peak was 0.44. But more importantly, the distribution was different. So where the hotspots are, where the peaks are, which regions are spared, is actually different across these three individuals. And so in each one of these individuals, if we were to double the current applied, everything would double. But for example, an individual who had a brain region that had no current flow in it, when we double the current, that region still won't have any current flow or electric field delivered to it locally. While an individual who does have something would receive the benefit. So you can see that it's even doubling current across subjects is not the same thing. And then in the second row is simply illustrating another montage. This is a bifrontal montage. It's used for different things, and including for the treatment of depression and trying to improve mood. But once again, you see that the pattern is different. And it's also different across montages. The M1SO doesn't produce the same distribution as the what we're calling the bilateral DLPFC montage for what it's trying to target. Doubling the current, therefore, in the second row is not doubling the same thing as doubling the current in the first row, and it's not the same across individuals. And finally, you see a high definition montage, This is a montage with electrode configuration that's designed to be more focal. And one virtue of this particular approach is that you can see that across individuals, the current is well restricted within the sort of ring that's formed by the electrodes of the 4X1 high definition TDCS montage. And so at least we don't have that variability across individuals. We have control over where it goes, but the peak does vary. And so even if we apply 1 milliamp across all these individuals, the peak in the brain is 0.15, 0.29, 0.9. Again, there's an individual variation here. I do want to emphasize these models have been validated. I'm going to skip it, you know, in the interest of time, but in this study that's going back now quite a few years, as well as recent studies where there was intracranial recordings from living human beings. These were patients who were had epilepsy and were candidates for resection, so they already had the electrodes in their head. These models have been validated, including the interindividual variability, including the focality. So this is something that we're confident that the models are giving us the correct predictions, and that's this top scale that I will revisit. I want to say a few words about this second scale. When the current enters the brain, when it crosses through a part of your gray matter, the hypothesis is that the primary mode of action is the polarization of neurons that are exposed to it. This is something that we and others have known for a very long time, and this is just one exemplary result of what happens. The takeaway of this figure here, if you look at the bottom where it talks about applied field, and then on the left axis, the resulting membrane polarization, as you apply more and more field, you polarize the cell more and more. And this is a largely a linear relationship, except for at some extremes. What that means is if I go from 1 milliamp TDCS to 2 milliamp TDCS, I will also double the electric field in any particular part of the brain, and therefore I will also double the amount of polarization that these neurons experience. So at the level of membrane polarization, at least in this experimental system for isolated cells, with all these other constraints, we do see linearities. All right, now I want to talk a little bit more about these animal studies. This was, by the way, from a hippocampal brain slice, and specifically talk about the notion of translation. So how do we look at dose response in animals, and how do we relate that to people? Again, this is a very complicated slide, and I'll go through it piece by piece, but there are some important ideas here that I think they're pretty essential to understand as far as dose response. So starting first with dose response in animals, and looking at the figure on the left. So when you have a dish, when you have a slice, it's possible to expose the whole population to a controlled electric field of, let's say, 0.25 volt per meter or more, 0.5 volt per meter or 0.75 for one. And so each dish will be exposed to different intensity electric field. All the neurons are exposed to the same electric field, and so then we can look at some outcome measure, firing rate, polarization, plasticity, and we can ask very basic questions about dose response. Does increasing the electric field increase the outcome? Then you can do something very similar in animal models. This is you're looking at a simulation of a rat brain. We can place an electrode. In this case, they're typically placed epicranially, and current can be applied. And you can see in the picture of the current flow prediction, there's sort of a hot spot right under the electrode where most of the current gets. But it does spread out a little bit. So in the region with the black, the region in the orange, you'll still get a little bit of electric field, but certainly less. So we can apply, for example, 0.01 milliamp to each rat or 0.05 milliamp to each rat. Now what you're seeing there in the jitter in the x-axis is the resulting electric field. So it turns out that even with these sort of inbred rats with, you know, age controls and weight controls, they're not all exactly the same. Their heads are not all exactly the same. And so when you get each one 0.1 milliamp, the resulting intensity that you get in the brain and even the pattern will vary a little bit. It'll jitter a little bit. So that's what you're seeing there in the red region, which is the target. Not everyone's getting the same electric field. There's a little bit of jitter. If we double the current, or in this case fivefold it, we get a big increase in the overall electric field, but you still are going to get that jitter. Still, there's this separation, and I think it's reasonable in these kind of animal models to ask the question, as I go and deliver more current, do I see a linear increase or a monotonic increase in my outcome measure, whatever that is, maybe it's behavior, maybe it's a neurophysiological measure, and so on. things get much more nuanced, I think, when you're talking about human studies. And again, let me just walk you through that to explain why. So let's start with the right. And this would be an example of, let's say, a conventional dose response experiment. You might do in individuals. You might take a population of just showing two individuals here, but it'd be a population, and you would give them 1 milliamp, and then either in that same population later or in a different population, you would give 2 milliamps, and you would ask the basic question, when I gave 1 milliamp, I saw some effect, and then when I give 2 milliamp, do I see a bigger effect? It seems reasonable, but let's start thinking about the actual current flow pattern. So again, we're looking at three, I'm looking at B2 here on the right, you're looking at three different regions. Now, the red region is the nominal target. That's the thing you were aiming for. Turns out that with many conventional TDCS montages using two pads, the area that gets the most electric field maybe isn't necessarily the one that you're aiming for. And so in this case, you can see that in sort of these lower plots, you get an electric field. You do get some electric field in the region that you're interested in, but of made up another region here, this region in black, that actually gets a higher current. So that's right away an interesting confound where the target where you think you're delivering the electric field, well, maybe it is or maybe it isn't your target. And then the yellow is in another region which gets a significant amount of electric field, though maybe not as much as the actual target. But now you're looking at the whole brain, and the whole brain is interconnected. And so going back to the point I emphasized before, when you're applying TDCS at some particular current, you're producing this distributed pattern, and it's not the same across individuals. And so what you're looking at there in that 1 milliamp chart is showing that at 1 milliamp, there's a distribution of what you'll see in the red region across individuals, the distribution of what you'll see in the other regions, and those things actually overlap. Meaning there could be an individual who in the yellow region, the yellow circuit region, actually gets more current than the red current region. Now in this case, when we double the amount of current that we give to everyone or to a different population, we shift that electric field plot upward. And so now everything is higher. But it's not so simple, because for example, as I've deliberately sort of tried to illustrate the case here, you can see that now the target region, the red region, right, may still not have more current at 2 milliamps than the non-target region had at 1. And so everything is shifted. And again, all these brain regions are interacting with one another. So now each brain region and each individual has been re-engaged in a different way. And so we could ask the question that's shown at the top in the question mark, if I give everyone more current, do I see more of an outcome measure? Does the clinical FC increase? But if I plot it that instead, if I ask that question in terms of electric field and the ROI, it becomes this rather big jitter. Now an alternative is what's shown in B1. Now in this case, it requires an individual MRI from each subject beforehand, because with that MRI, we can generate a model for each individual. And what we can do in this case is we can say, okay, our goal is to apply 0.5 volt per meter to this one ROI. And with this montage for each individual, this is how much current that individual needs to get to produce 0.5 volt per meter in that region. So for example, I'm a subject, you're a subject. It turns out that I need 1 milliamp to produce 0.5 volt per meter in that red region, but you need 1.35 milliamp to produce 0.5 volt in the same region and so on. So by definition, everyone's getting a different current to produce that same electric field. And that's where you see that really tight band under 0.5 volt per meter right there. But you still have these other brain regions. And now I'm showing you a jitter again, because the ratio of the electric field in the target, even though we have our target and we've nailed it, the ratio of the electric field in that target to other brain regions isn't the same. And so you produce this distribution again. And when you double the current, you're sort of shifting it forward. Now, in this case, we can ask the question, given the fact that we did this modeling, does an electric field in the ROI of 0.5 versus an electric field in the ROI of 1 volt per meter, does the 1 volt per meter produce a bigger response? But you can see it's not an entirely clean experiment for all this complexity that I'm explaining here. Now, I did mention there's a focal form of TDCS called high definition TDCS, specifically using what we call the 4x1 montage. It's like a ring montage that does restrict current to particular regions. Now, in example C2, we're using the 4x1 montage, but everyone's getting the same current, so 1-2 milliamp, and we can get sort of that more idealized, really getting a separation between what would be our ROI and other brain regions. But as far as electric field, things are a little bit mixed up, but I think it's a certainly cleaner potential experiment. And in C1, you can see this notion of fixed electric field. So in this case, we're using the 4x1 montage, and each individual is getting an MRI and a custom model to get the same electric field there. And let me just say, I've certainly, in the interest of time, I know I've certainly gone through this very quickly, and it is in the paper. I guess one of my real takeaway messages here is that it's not so simple. Even when you set out to do these dose response studies, even when you recognize this is absolutely critical, you have to be aware of these limitations. And so in the interest of time, I'm going to only say a few words about each one of these scales. People certainly have looked at TDCS at the network level. We have as well. And I'll have some references at the end on this. Certainly at the network level, things become much more complicated. It's not like at the single cell isolated level where you see this linear polarization. Networks are active, and the way they respond to fields of increasing intensity is often monotonic, but rarely linear. And by the time you get to human clinical neurophysiology, by the time you get to cognition and behavior, what we found in this review, I would say it wasn't just that there was incomplete evidence, you know, sort of as the title said. I really think that there is evidence against, right, by us and by other groups, there's evidence against a simpler linear monotonic relationship, meaning there's clearly studies showing that if you, let's say, double the intensity, the effect might actually reverse in direction, or the effect might go away. And I think it's really important to emphasize, you know, this is not sort of a somehow mark against TDCS. This is, I would say, a virtue of TDCS that people have started to do these dose response studies, at least in that 1-2 milliamp range, and they are finding these very subtle differences. So very briefly, one major source of that difference is actually brain state. As I mentioned before, TDCS is not applied on its own. It's typically combined with some sort of task, some sort of training. So there's a task, there's some sort of computer task that they would naturally be getting better at. You're applying TDCS to try to boost that learning curve, or simply boost performance while TDCS is on. And what is very well established about TDCS that is it's very brain state dependent. And I don't have time to unpack that today. I will provide some references. I'm happy to answer questions afterward. But the effects of TDCS produces a very low electric field in the brain, very low intensity. And because of that, it turns out that how TDCS affects brain function is very state dependent. We consider that a good thing. In my group, it's something that we've called functional selectivity. It turns out that it can actually support this specificity, this notion that TDCS can be used for many different things. But for now, I just want to say that this is a very well-known source of variability in TDCS, and it's a further confound or something, let's say, to a regressor control on top of all the other issues I brought up. So that's the state dependency, and let me just, I'm out of time, so let me just really wrap up very quickly. So these questions are not just, let's say, academic or purely mechanistic. They have very significant translational repercussions. For example, they address the question of, should we think of TDCS as something that boosts brain plasticity, or should we think of it as something that in either a hermetic way or some other way acts as like a preconditioner? Depending on how we think about these things, depending on how we think about then the resulting dose response, we address questions like, should TDCS be applied before a task, or should it be applied during the task, during the therapy, or during the training? And ultimately, this sort of mother question that I've been dancing around, which is more current more? And these are some additional references. You can find them on my website. It's illustrated there. The first one has to do with oscillations. The second one, I think, should be a good review of all the cellular mechanisms, which I'm very sorry I didn't have the scope to get into today, as well as two of these sort of broad reviews that would be useful. So, thank you for your attention.